Okay, we will get started now. So I hope it's not a news that midterm is on Wednesday. So I sent out an email last week, so I hope everyone knows it. And the syllabus for midterm is everything we have covered until KKT theorem.
Could you postpone it to Friday?
Why?
Because it is too much.
But you got like a nice break to go over all the stuff that has been covered in the class. No?
Yeah, but not all.
No, unfortunately, I can't change it because this was given in the syllabus at the very beginning of the class.
Syllabus for until non-linear, it does not cover the linear program for the syllabus.
Yes. What? So until KKT conditions, KKT theorem?
No, it does not cover linear for the syllabus.
What do you mean linear?
The linear program, the KKT is also covering linear programs, right?
So I don't know when did we discuss linear programming?
The KKT does not cover not the linear and the manifold of sub-optimization is not for linear.
So linear sub-manifold is we did that ages ago. Like yeah. It's millions of years ago we studied sub-manifold optimization. So no, then after sub-manifold we talked about Lagrange multiplier theorem, then we talked about KKT theorem, then we talked about barrier method, then we talked about Lagrangian method in the previous class, and today we are going to talk about the next method. So KKT was also done millions of years ago. Since then, a lot of things have happened in the class. refer to videos if you have any questions. All right, or you can come to my office hours, that's right after, at 4:15 p.m. today. Okay, we can discuss if you have any questions. Okay. So far we have talked about barrier method for solving inequality constraint problems, and it required a point to, it had certain conditions under which you can use barrier method. And then we talked about augmented Lagrangian method for equality constraint problem, and then for inequality constraint problem you can lift it into a higher dimensional optimization problem, into an equality constraint problem, and then you can apply the augmented Lagrangian method for those problems. And the key idea there is to transform the original problem in such a manner that solving a new optimization problem is much easier. And what you do is you don't solve one optimization problem at one point of time. You solve a sequence of optimization problems using the solution to the last sequence as a starting point for the new optimization problem, right? And that was the barrier method as well as augmented Lagrangian method. So in the barrier method, you had this parameter epsilon k multiplied by barrier function bx, and you let epsilon k go to 0, and you try and the result was that xk would converge to x star as k goes to infinity. In the augmented Lagrangian method, you had a parameter ck, and you let ck go to infinity, and your barrier method, your augmented Lagrangian method would yield a solution that satisfies first order necessary condition for optimality. And the third topic we studied was method of multipliers, where you pick your lambda k sequence in a very specific fashion, and you had an added benefit of lambda k converging to lambda star, which would be the Lagrange multiplier for that problem. Now we want to solve problems that are unconstrained optimization problems, but they are derived from the original constrained optimization problem using a penalty function. So what I want to say is that I want to minimize fx such that h of x is equal to 0, x is in Rn. I want to transform this problem such that I have minimum x in Rn of some function, let me call this p tilde x. And this is an unconstrained problem. And the solution to this problem should be the same as solution to this problem. That's what we want. We want to construct such p tilde so that the solutions are the same for the two problems. Okay. What would be a first natural choice for p tilde? What is it that we want to get? Okay, so let's think about it this way. What is it that we want to get out of this problem? So let's In order to solve this problem, we want to find x star lambda star right? This is what we want to get in order to solve this problem. Okay. Now my question is, how can I construct a P tilde such that if I solve this problem, I might be able to get a value of x star comma lambda star, a tuple x star lambda star. Let me change it to y, because your y could include lambda star as one of the optimization variables besides x. R P. Any thoughts? I want to construct P tilde in such a fashion that solving this problem would give me a solution to this problem, or a potential solution to this problem. Okay, let me write one. Okay. I just want to minimize the two norm of the gradient of Lagrangian plus the two norm of h of x. So this is always non-negative, right? Because it's the sum of two non-negative numbers. And it is exactly equal to zero at x star comma lambda star, right? So if I solve this problem, I want to minimize p tilde x comma lambda in Rn cross Rm. If I solve this problem using gradient descent or Newton's method or whatever is my favorite method, if it converges to x star lambda star, it is quite likely that it will satisfy this equality constraints, which is the first derivative of the Lagrangian will be zero and the constraint will also be equal to zero. But there is a problem with this formulation. What's the problem? So we know that it's non-negative, so a value of zero would be globally optimal. But p of x comma p tilde itself may not be a convex function, right? It may be a non-convex function. So even though it will have a solution that is equal to zero, it may have other solution that may not be equal to zero. So this is your x star lambda star, which is a, so this is my p of x comma lambda. So this is the point I want to get at, but this is also a local minimum, so gradient descent would converge to this particular point, thereby not converging to a solution to this problem. Okay, so this penalty function doesn't seem to be a good penalty function, because while a solution to the original problem is a solution to this problem, the other way doesn't hold. So a solution to this problem, or a local minimum to this problem, may not be a minimum, a local minimum for the original problem I started with. So this is not a good approach. Not a good penalty function. Okay? So we need to come up with some other penalty function so that a solution to this problem would lead us to a solution to this problem. So we want it to go the other way. In this case, it's only going from here to here, which means the solution to this is a solution to this, but not the other way around. So we want to change that situation. So here is what a good penalty function would look like. I want to minimize x in Rn fx plus c px. C is a positive number, and p of x, this is capital P of x, is max of absolute value of h1 of x, absolute value of hm of x. Okay. So this is a constrained optimization problem. I created another unconstrained optimization problem. And my claim is, which I'm going to write formally, if C is sufficiently large, then an optimal solution to this problem or a local minimum to this problem is a local minimum to this problem, okay? Which is exactly what we wanted. Okay, let me say it out again. If C is sufficiently large, so C is greater than zero, so if C is sufficiently large, then an unconstrained local minimum to this problem is a local minimum to the original problem we started with. So let's see what the precise condition is. X star is regular, second order sufficiency condition is satisfied. If C is greater than summation I equals 1 to m, absolute value of lambda I star, then fx plus c px is strictly greater than f of x star for all x in b epsilon x star, x not equal to x star. And I'm going to define B epsilon X star is X such that X minus X star is less than epsilon. So this is an epsilon neighborhood around X star. Yes?
Could we define the penalty function as F of X plus C over 2 second norm of H squared?
So that's the augmented Lagrangian method.
Yeah.
But there you needed a constraint that h of x is equal to 0. Yeah, but here this is an unconstrained problem. This is completely unconstrained. In the augmented Lagrangian method, we still had to retain the constraint that h of x is equal to 0. Okay? But that was exactly what we were doing in augmented Lagrangian. Yeah.
So this is just a more general version of like augmented?
No, I don't think it would be considered as a generalization of augmented Lagrangian. This is just another method. Okay. Not a generalization. Yes?
That maximum operation is going to be resolved in the
Yes, it will be. And we will figure out a way to get around that problem. But yes, this penalty function is not differentiable. Okay. Any other question? Yes.
Why would you use a different norm other than one norm for leaves?
You can use other norms too, but you will have to prove this, a result of this type. Okay. The book has some more discussion about other forms of penalty function, but we are only going to talk about this one because it leads to a very cool algorithm in the end.
We have the determinacy.
Sorry?
We have the determinacy, or like, just kind of like how we have to determine lambda in the previous constraint.
Okay. So the question is, do we need to determine this parameter C that we are using here? C needs to be sufficiently large, but we don't quite know a priori what lambda I star, sum of lambda I star is going to be. So in the end, I'm going to tell you how exactly you can estimate the value of summation of lambda I star. Okay? Okay, but for now, just assume that C is sufficiently large. Okay? If you knew, for instance, again, in electricity market, I'll go back again and again, if you have solved that problem for a million times, in the past, you kind of know what the value of summation of lambda i star is going to be like, given the current problem formulation and the current parameters. So you use some sort of historical data to come up with this estimate, and then you pick a value of C which is much larger than that. In case you don't know what the value of summation of lambda I star is, then there is a way to figure it out, which I'm going to cover in the end. Okay, so to begin with, I'm going to prove this result. Okay, because it's important. And I'm going to define some notation. So I define U of epsilon is equal to H of X, X in B epsilon X star. I'm going to define P of U. Min fx such that hx is equal to u. Oh, and x minus x star, x in b epsilon x star. Okay, so I'm going to define these two quantities. One is the set of all possible constraints. If your set X is equal to X is in B epsilon X star. And the second is P of U, which is the usual function we considered in the sensitivity theorem. From sensitivity theorem, we know that gradient of P0 is minus lambda star. That comes from sensitivity theorem. Okay. Minimum of fx plus cpx X in B epsilon X star, I'm going to split it into two optimization problems. I'm writing min, but I don't know whether min exists or not, so let me change it with inf. Inf of U in U epsilon, inf over X in B epsilon X star, H of X equal to U, F of X plus C, absolute value max of UI, I equals 1 to M. Okay. So what am I doing here? I am at x star. This is my radius epsilon. And I want to minimize this function over this entire space. So what I do is I consider hx equal to u curves, hx equal to u, x and b epsilon x star. I minimize f of x plus cpx. But since h of x is equal to u, I can write px as max of absolute value of ui, okay, because h of x is equal to u along this entire manifold. And then I do the minimization over all possible u in u epsilon, which is the set of all possible u's you can get within this. Okay, so these are all hx equal to u, u bar, u tilde, right? All this u, u bar, u tilde, they are all part of the set u epsilon by definition. So instead of trying to minimize a function over this entire space at once, I'm minimizing it along certain curves and then doing the overall minimization along all possible such curves. Okay? And there is no loss of generality here, so that's why there is an equality here. There's no other nothing fancy that we are doing here. Now, this is not a function of x. Okay, it's just a function of u. So this is the only function of x, and I'm taking an infimum with respect to x here. Okay? So this is equal to inf u in u epsilon c max of ui plus inf f of x in b epsilon x star h of x equal to u. Since this is not participating in infimization, I can take it out of this first infimum. Okay. Any questions so far? Yes. This one? Oh, I erased the figure. It is the set of all possible curves, right? So I've considered the set of all possible curves here, and if you take the union of all those curves, you get the entire ball at once. So that's why I could split this optimization into two infimums. And then this term is not part, this is not a function of x, so I can take it out of this first infimum and put it outside of this infimum. Now, what is this equal to? This is p of u by definition. Okay? So I'm going to name this function pc of u, which is p of u plus c max of absolute value of ui. Okay? Any questions so far? This is just definition. All right. So remember from our discussion on sensitivity theorem that this function p is actually infinitely differentiable if f on h are infinitely differentiable, right? And the first derivative was equal to minus lambda star. And the way we proved that this is infinitely differentiable is using implicit function theorem. So you can actually apply the mean value theorem to conclude that P of U equals to P of 0 plus gradient P of 0 transpose U plus half U transpose second derivative of P alpha bar U, where alpha bar is some number between 0 and 1. Okay? This is the mean value theorem for second order Taylor series. Okay? So all of you, so this comes from sensitivity theorem. These are just renaming of functions. So now we have all the background to actually solve, to prove the statement that we started with. Any questions? Okay. What I'm going to do now is substitute PU with this expression using mean value theorem and rewrite PC of U in a specific fashion. So PC of U is equal to P0 minus summation of lambda I star UI plus half U transpose second derivative of PU plus C absolute value of UI. Okay, pick gamma greater than 0 such that C is greater than equal to summation of lambda I star plus gamma I equals 1 to m. Okay, so by assumption, my C is strictly greater than this summation, so I can insert a gamma which is positive, such that C satisfies this relationship. And now I'm going to substitute that in here. And then collect the term, so what I get is PC of U is greater than P0 plus half what else do I have? Plus summation I equals 1 to m, absolute value of lambda I max of ui minus lambda I ui. Actually, let me not use I here, let me use j. Yeah, lambda I star, that's right. So gradient of P0 was negative lambda I star, so. What do you think about this term? Is it positive, negative, zero? Don't know, can't say. So I have absolute value of lambda I star and max of all possible u, absolute value of u, minus the usual lambda I star multiplied by the usual ui star. Sorry? It will be positive. Well, it will be greater than or equal to zero. So yeah, it will be non-negative. So who said that? Okay, how many of you agree with him? Okay, many of you. Okay, all right. So maybe I don't need to go through the proof of this. So this is absolute value. So this is certainly non-negative. This is the max over all possible uj's. So that's going to be a big number. And this is individual lambda I star with the negative sign. So it could be positive, it could be negative, but it doesn't matter. And this term is always going to dominate this term as well as multiplied by this term. So all in all, this term is going to be this term is going to be larger than this term individually for each I, and therefore the summation of such terms will be non-negative. Okay? So what I get is Pc of u is greater than equal to P0 plus half, okay, let me write it on the other side. So Pc of u is going to be greater than equal to P0 plus half u transpose u plus gamma max of I, absolute value of ui. Okay? So this is what we got so far. Now let's look at these two terms and assume that epsilon is very, very small. This epsilon we started with is extremely small. What will happen to u epsilon? So remember that x star, h of x is equal to 0, right? And I'm looking at all values of x that are very close to x star, and h is a continuous function. So the values that hx will take will also be very, very small, right? Because you're not perturbing too much from x star. So u epsilon will contain all possible u's that have very small magnitude. So u is small, and since u is small, this is the first order term containing u, this is the second order term containing u, so all the cross terms of u will appear here. So this term will also be greater than zero for u small. Actually, I should say for epsilon small, because epsilon small for all u in u epsilon. Okay? Let me retrace the argument. So at x star, h of x star is equal to 0. If I move x a little bit from x star, my h of x will not change too much. So my h of x will be very, very close to 0, which means u epsilon is a set of all, the magnitude of u in u epsilon is very, very small. So for epsilon small, the values in u epsilon is going to be very small. This is first order term in u. This is second order term in u containing all the cross terms, u transpose u terms. And therefore, this value will be dominated by this term. The value of this will be dominated by this term. And therefore, this is going to be non-negative because this is positive, this is positive. And this can take any positive or negative values. We don't know. So by the way, we don't quite know whether p is a second, is a convex function or not. All we know is that the derivative of p is minus lambda star. Okay, so this could be negative value, this could be positive value, we don't know. But this term is certainly going to dominate the second order term for u very small. So this implies that Pc of u is greater than P of 0. What is P of 0, by the way? What is P of 0? So f of x such that h of x is equal to 0, x is in B epsilon x star. So P of 0 is actually f x star. Okay, a lot of things have happened in the class by now, okay. So I'll give you a few moments to digest all this discussion. This is also equal to Pc of 0. Okay, any questions so far? This one is strictly greater than, because this term is strictly positive for u sufficiently small. For u in u epsilon, u not equal to 0. So this is going to be true for all u in u epsilon, u not equal to 0. Okay, now we also know that for all x in B epsilon x star, h of x equal to u, fx plus c px is greater than equal to pc of u. U not equal to 0. Okay, so combining these two facts, we conclude that f of x plus cpx is greater than equal to, no, it's strictly greater than fx star for all x not equal to x star, x in B epsilon x. And this is strict inequality. Okay. Questions? Oh, of course, yeah. B epsilon x star, that's right. Okay, so let's go through the train of thought. We started with some function. We did some massaging, which is pretty usual in optimization. So once you go through this course, this would become your second nature to massage an optimization problem. So we did this massaging, and then we got everything in the right format that we needed. Once we got it in this format, we realized that C can be written in this fashion, and then we figured out that, okay, this term can be neglected. Well, it's not neglected, but this is non-negative, so I can remove this term without really changing the inequality sign. And then the second thing we noted was that since this is a first-order term, this is a second-order term, for u very, very small, this term will be dominated by this term, and therefore this will be strictly positive because gamma is positive. So that leads us to this result that Pc of u is greater than f of x star, which is equal to Pc of 0 for all u in u epsilon, u not equal to 0. Okay? Now, because of this reason, so f of x plus cpx is greater than or equal to the inf of f of x such that x is in b epsilon x star hx equal to u plus c max of ui. So that's why I have f of x plus cpx is greater than or equal to pc of u for all u not equal to 0, u in u epsilon. Okay, so I have this result. I mean, not result, but this is by construction that we have done here. So this follows. And combining this result with this particular result, I have that f of x plus cpx is greater than f of x star for all x not equal to x star, x is in b epsilon x star, which means that x star is a local minimum for fx plus cpx. Okay? And since this is a local minimum, that's exactly what we wanted to prove, that f of x plus cpx is minimized at x star. So it will be a local minimum in a small neighborhood around x star. And so if you run a gradient descent algorithm on f of x plus cpx, no matter what, well, as long as you converge to a local minimum, you know that it is also a solution to the original optimization problem you started with. Okay? Yes?
How did that infimum of fx, that be u, how was it formulated?
How is this?
Yeah, how is this formulated?
How is this formulated? What do you mean by how it?
We have fx plus c max ui.
Right.
From here, how did we go to this video?
So, remember we had this intermediate step where we restricted ourselves to hx equal to u manifold, and then we minimized the objective function, and this is exactly equal to p of x when h of x is equal to u. Now we see that this particular term is independent of x, so I can pull it out, and I just have infimum with respect to x term in the inner infimum. Yes?
When we move from that step to the step on this side,
yeah,
we could have actually dropped the equality sign because since the lower summation term is greater than 0.
It's greater than equal to 0. So that's why we couldn't drop it. Okay. We could have dropped it here. I mean, we definitely dropped it here because this is strictly greater than 0. And this is also strictly greater than 0 when u is not equal to 0. Because at u equal to 0, this term will vanish. It'll be equal to 0. Okay. You can do the same exercise for inequality constraint problem by transforming it into equality constraint problem. So overall, we get the following result. I want to minimize fx. X in Rn, I define a penalty function p of x as max of And then the theorem is, so this is my penalty function, x star regular and satisfies SOSC. This implies that, no, pick C greater than summation absolute value of lambda I star plus summation mu j star then fx plus cpx is greater than fx star for all x in v epsilon x star. X not equal to X star. Okay. So I have, instead of using absolute value of h1 of x, I'm using h1 of x and minus h1 of x. So that gives me the absolute max of absolute value of hi's of x. And then g1 and gj's are all, there's no absolute value around g1 to gj. So this works fine. And I pick a C which is sufficiently large, then I can just solve the unconstrained minimization of fx plus cpx. And no matter which solution it converges to, any local minimum of this is also a local minimum to the original problem we started with. Yes.
Here in the bx penalty, it goes to gr.
Oh yeah, of course, gr. Yeah. So all the zero, because gx is less than equal to zero, so you don't want a negative value of gj to impact the penalty. So you have zero g1x to gr of x, and the absolute value of h1 to hm of x. Okay. Now we also need to address the elephant in the room, which is the fact that p of x is not differentiable, as someone rightly pointed out. So how do you do the unconstrained minimization of fx plus cpx? That's the question. Okay. So let's think about it. You know what, I have only 2 minutes left. So maybe you can think about it at home. Okay, and maybe we'll discuss it on, Friday. Okay, yeah. So we'll discuss it. We'll come back to this particular, so how to solve an optimization problem of this type. We'll talk about it on Friday. All right, thank you.